A very good morning to all of you. It is my proud privilege to welcome you all on behalf of ICRIER and LSE Observatory to this seminar on a very important topic, towards a sustainable energy strategy for India by Montek, Ahluwalia, Lord Nicholas Stern, and Himanshu Gupta. First of all, I would like to welcome our founder member and former Prime Minister, Dr. Manmohan Singh, to the seminar. We feel very honored by your presence, sir. May I request ICRIER's Director and Chief Executive, Dr. Rajat Kathuria, to felicitate Dr. Singh with flowers, please. I would also like to take this opportunity to welcome my colleagues on the board of ICRIER who have taken the morning before the board meeting to participate in the seminar. I am very happy to see many distinguished persons and professors from ICRIER and other faculty in this audience and warmly welcome all of you to the seminar. We at ICRIER are very proud that one of our board members, Lord Stern, and one of our founder members, Montek, Ahluwalia, are collaborating with a young scholar, Himanshu Gupta, who first worked in the Planning Commission on these issues, and then in Niti Aayog, is now studying at Stanford, and who I understand has been selected this year for the Forbes 30 Under 30 Award. So an applause for Himanshu, please. For the past 5 years or so, we at ICRIER have developed two closely related thrust areas of research, namely urbanization and climate change. Recognizing that business as usual urbanization poses serious threat to the sustainability of our growth and development process, ICRIER initiated a research and capacity building program on urbanization with support from the Ministry of Urban Development, Government of India, and working closely with state governments and urban local governments. On climate change, we are at an advanced stage of a major study on climate change and economic competitiveness of cities, making the business case for adaptation based on a comparative case analysis of 4 Indian cities, Pune, Surat, Kochi, and Ludhiana. This study is funded by the Rockefeller Foundation and led by Professor Meenu Tiwari. ICRIER is one of the country partners in the Global Commission on the Economy and Climate under the leadership of Lord Nicholas Stern. The New Climate Economy, the flagship project of the Commission, aims to bring together the economic argument for climate policy as advocated by the Stern report. It seeks to conduct an independent analysis of the impacts of transition to a low carbon economy. We at ICRIER prepared the country report for India sustaining rapid development in a new climate economy and also contributed to the global report. We are continuing with more research on aspects of climate change which are important for city planning and urban management. We are also working towards a proposed India-China dialogue, which is a collaboration between Tsinghua University in China, ICRIER, and New Climate Economy. More recently, we have taken up a research study on decarbonization planning of Indian railways. Mr. Suresh Prabhu, the Honorable Minister for Railways, will be joining us a little later to make his comments on the findings of this study. I would like at the end to acknowledge the dynamic role played by our Director and Chief Executive, Dr. Rajat Kathuria, in guiding ICRIER's research efforts in this very important direction. With this background, I would like to acknowledge our deep appreciation to Lord Stern and Montek Ahluwalia to agree to our request to prepare this study, which is being presented here. Our thanks to Himanshu Gupta for collaborating with them. Now, without taking any further time, I invite Montek Ahluwalia to begin the presentation.
Thank you, Isha. And on behalf of my co-authors, I'd like to thank ICRIER for giving us this opportunity. Let me just say that this is a work in progress, so we've not actually circulated the paper except to the two discussants. But can I be heard? Can you hear me at the back? Yes? No? Okay. Let me just... Can you just switch the slide? Go to the second slide. I'm going to pull this one. Okay. Yeah. You know, we have a very short list of slides, but this one just gives you an overview. I mean, I just want to make a few points. That one, we're looking at energy trajectory of India over the period 2012 to 2047. And 47 was chosen instead of the more conventional 2050 because it's India's 100th anniversary of independence. And therefore, that's the oddity there. And we're using, for the projections, the Niti Aayog version 2 calculator. This essentially enables you to feed in assumptions and then get out some of the stuff you want. And we're using it to look at two things. One, the degree of import dependence, and second, CO2 equivalent emissions. Although it says CO2, it's actually CO2 equivalent coming out of energy use in all sectors. So we've used this calculator to make two different projections. One is a business as usual projection, and the other is a low carbon alternative. Now you'll see from the slides as we proceed that the business as usual, which is essentially a continuation of what is happening, Himanshu will explain all this, the business as usual is just not acceptable. The low carbon is much better, and the real name of the game is how do you get there? So Nick and I, after Himanshu has made his 4 or 5 slide presentation, will talk about me first and then Nick, some of the policy implications of the results. And Nick in particular will focus on the international aspects and also make a comparison of what our low carbon or indeed BAU looks like compared to China. So with that very brief introduction, let me invite Himanshu to bring out for you the details of the calculator.
Thanks, Mr. Ahluwalia. So as Mr. Ahluwalia mentioned, the estimates of our study are based on the version 2 of the Indian Energy Security Scenarios 2047 calculator of Niti Aayog. The underlying objective of that calculator was to generate scenarios for the Indian economy till 2047, which is 100 years of India's independence. So the way we generate scenarios is by playing along the levels of energy efficiency in the demand sectors and by playing along the levels of technology deployment in the supply sectors. So in the demand sectors, we have transport, both passenger and freight. We generate individual scenarios for passenger and freight transport in India till 2047, buildings, industry, agriculture, telecom, and cooking. In the supply sectors, we have fossil fuels, renewables, bioenergy, and even new technologies like hydrogen and cross-border electricity trade. So the way we generate scenarios is by playing along the levels of technology deployment in the supply sector and the levels of energy efficiency in the demand sectors. I'll explain to you what these levels mean. Level one means like very pessimistic deployment of technologies in the supply sectors till 2047, and marginal improvements in energy efficiency, or in fact no improvements in energy efficiency in the demand sectors from now to 2047. Level two, we call it a determined effort, which is if the outcomes of the current policies are realized in the best possible way, then what's going to be the picture till 2047? Level three is slightly aggressive than level two. And level four is a heroic effort, which means we utilize the maximal potential of solar and wind energy, for example, in India. And we also exploit the maximal potential of energy efficiency penetrations in industry, transport, and buildings. So the way we generated projections from using the calculator was based on these fundamental assumptions about the Indian economy, wherein we said that by 2047, India's population will be around 1.7 billion. Around 50% of Indians will be living in cities by 2047. Indian economy will grow at a 7.4% rate from now to 2047. This is a cumulative aggregate, a compound aggregate growth rate. And the share of manufacturing will rise to 30% in 2047. So the tool can ideally generate millions of scenarios, millions of pathways. So we pick like business as usual pathway and the low carbon pathway. Now, so business as usual pathway was based on, you know, the extrapolation of past trends of efforts in the development of the current policies. And by which I mean some experts we talked to felt that the levels of energy efficiency penetration in transport sector is suboptimal. Hence, we selected level one as the business as usual pathway for transport. And in other sectors, in other demand sectors and supply sectors, we felt that the current levels of deployment are just optimal. And hence, we picked level two for the as the BAU for the other supply and demand sectors. The other pathway was the low carbon pathway. And the four ingredients of that low carbon pathway is A, you minimize the resource consumption across all the demand sectors by having better cities, which the co-authors will talk to you about. Then once you have minimized the resource consumption, you minimize energy consumption required to produce and consume those resources. Then you supply energy required to produce and consume the resources through electricity rather than fossil fuels. And then whatever electricity you have in the portfolio, you try and increase the share of renewables in that portfolio. So in consonance with all those four ingredients, we believe that level one of coal-based capacities, which is the pessimistic level of coal, and level three of solar and wind, and level four of bioenergy, will realize the component D of the low carbon pathway. And the 17 user choices which are there in the paper, along the 8 demand sectors, will realize, you know, the components A, B, C of the low carbon pathway. With that, I'll hand over to Mr. Ahluwalia.
Thank you, Himanshu. Just as a guide, in the handout that has been distributed, you will see a set of boxes 1 to 8. Now, those boxes relate to the 8 sectors, the demand side sectors, which use energy. And within each sector, they actually indicate what are the changes that we are making. I don't propose to go over them, but if anyone wants to see, that's not in the summary, it's in the folder that's being given. And there is a written executive summary there, and that has an attachment. So box A, 1 to 8, gives you all of that. So with that, let me go straight to the results, because really we want to focus on policy, not the numbers. The first thing that we have looked at is, what does all this mean for import dependence? And as you can see,
there are two alternative results for 2047. One is the business as usual, and the other is the low carbon scenario. Now, based on the numbers we have, one consequence of business as usual is simply that import dependence will become unacceptable. Coal, for example, which begins with importing 18% of the requirement, if you go down a business as usual route, given the constraints that exist in increasing domestic coal production, you know, you can get an increase in 1 year, but if you look at where our coal is located, forests, et cetera, it's worthwhile making a very pessimistic or at least a very cautious assumption. That comes out to be an import dependence in coal of 57%. Oil becomes 90%, gas 43%, and if you take all energy together in terms of millions of tons of oil equivalent, then it becomes as high as 59%. The low carbon scenario, on the other hand, mainly because it's reducing quite a bit on the demand side and is increasing not fossil fuels, but the renewables, leads to a much lower import dependence, which is actually quite manageable. And I want to pick up a point that Himanshu made just to emphasize it, that one of the key things in this whole process is when you bring in renewables, renewables can only generate electricity. And in our system, the share of electricity in total energy is very low. In 2012, only about 18.3% of total energy is in the form of electricity. And we need to increase the, so to speak, the electrification of the economy in order to be able to use renewables. That's just a detail and I want to mention. So import dependence, it's what they call a no-brainer. The business as usual doesn't work. Now, let's turn to the second. Now, this is, before we get to emissions, I just want to focus attention on this very basic equation, where EM by GDP is the emissions intensity of GDP. EM is emissions. Now, you know that you can see that EM divided by GDP is just energy divided by GDP multiplied by emissions divided by energy. I mean, the two E's cancel out and you get emissions divided by GDP on both sides. The first term in brackets is actually energy efficiency. Like, can you produce the same GDP with less energy? So these are all the demand side interventions that Himanshu talked about. The second term is really, can you change the composition of energy to make it less emissions intensive? So that's the switch from fossil fuels to greener energy and so on. So whatever we do, or whoever does whatever, if you want to reduce emissions to GDP, you've got to operate on one of these two things. So with that, let's go and look at what the results say. These results show that what's happening on the energy front. Energy intensity of GDP is very often talked about as a measure of energy efficiency. And you can see that in both business as usual and in the low carbon scenario, the energy intensity of GDP does go down. The next thing is the emissions intensity of GDP, which is actually quite different, because it depends on what the composition of the energy is. And if a lot of the energy is coming from coal, the emissions intensity is not going to be much benefited. Even there, the business as usual, there's an improvement. And in the low carbon, it goes down even further. You know, we find that in the business as usual, even in the business as usual, we are likely to meet the INDCs, the independent, nationally determined contributions that we have made in the climate change negotiations. We will meet those, but those are actually quite modest. And the real problem you can see in the third and the fourth slide, so let's that tells you total emissions and then emissions per capita. So just focus on emissions per capita. In the business as usual, the emissions per capita in 2047 will go from 1.7 tons per capita to 5.9 tons per capita. And just to give a reference, the global talk is that the whole world should come to an average of 2 tons per capita by 2050. The world is not on track for doing that. I mean, even what the industrialized countries have proposed will reduce their emissions per capita up to 2030, but it won't be on a track that gets them to 2. But what they're saying is that they are working themselves up to doing more, et cetera, et cetera. So it's quite clear that if they do succeed in getting to that level, we will be way off the chart, because we will be at 5.9 under business as usual. So this simply emphasizes that from an emissions point of view, it is important that we try to move to a low carbon scenario as fast as we can. Now, this table tells you what the contribution of different interventions is in getting to the low carbon scenario. See, we start off with 10,002, that should be 10,027 metric tons in the BAU for 2047, okay? And the demand side stuff brings you down to 6,231. So almost a 40% reduction comes from the energy efficiency components, which are laid out in all the box 1 to 8. Then we have some interventions on the supply side, and the last two are what you might call the contributions of the renewables, increasing the share of electricity being produced by renewables. But please note that the total, the last two numbers, 169 plus 275, only gives you about 450 or so. And the total reduction from 10,000 to 5,600 is something of the order of 4,600 or so. So actually, in the public debate, globally and domestically, there is a lot of focus on the green energy component, solar, and all of which is necessary and very good. But it's a complete mistake, I think, to think that if we do everything that's possible there, then we're all right. In other countries, by the way, the proportion between energy efficiency and green energy may be different. Nick will comment on that. But in our case, there's huge scope for energy efficiency. And from a policy point of view, that's really what we need to keep in mind. Now, a few pictures. One is total emissions. In the BAU, the total emissions just keep rising. In the low carbon, the total emissions sort of peak at 2042 and then go down. 2042 is a long way away, but at least we won't have the situation which we have at present, where basically, globally, China is seen to have made some kind of a commitment to peaking. We have not made any comment on that. What I'm saying is that if we move to the sort of thing we need, then there will be peaking. And this is what happens to coal consumption. In the business as usual, coal consumption will go on to about 2,000, this is consumption, not production, 2,704 million tons, yes. Whereas in the low carbon, it'll peak at about 1,739 and then come down to 1,426. Now, linked to this is what happens to the trajectory of energy based on thermal generation. I mean, if we start assuming that we are going to be having an energy strategy based on continuously expanding thermal generation, then you have one set of implications. If you think this transition is coming, then you have another. And remember that, you know, 30 years, when we are talking about setting up capacity to set up generating stations, over a long period, we need to see what that pattern should actually be like. This is the trajectory of per capita emissions historically. I mean, this is actually Nick's slide, so I won't deal with this. He's going to deal with this in greater detail. So from my point of view, let me make a few comments on the policy side. And I think we will actually overlap, and Nick can say, we'll give his views on more or less the same things, perhaps emphasizing some things differently. But on policy, I want to refer you to box 9, which is in the handout called Executive Summary, contained in the pad. Now, box 9 I think the main thing box 9 shows is that in each of these broad areas, there's no one thing that's going to solve the problem. You need to intervene at multiple levels. And each of those levels of intervention lies in the domain of different levels of government. I mean, for example, energy pricing for coal and, say, oil and so on, that's in the domain of the central government. But if you're going to have standards for buildings, that's all in the domain of state governments and sometimes municipalities. If you want to do something on parking charges, that's in the domain entirely of municipalities. So if you look at box 9, the columns indicate what are the things in the domain of the central government and what are the things in the domain of state governments and even municipalities. The total interventions that are listed in box 9 are about 59. So, and by the way, that's not comprehensive. I mean, once you get into the spirit of this with greater detail, there'll be more. So one of the biggest challenges, and this is my first point, that there's no single policy that is necessary. There are a multiplicity of policies, the responsibility for which rests at different levels of government. And, you know, we can't have a top-down strategy where everything is planned. But at the same time, we have to have a shared understanding that this is what the central government is going to do and this is what states have to do, et cetera. And somehow that needs to evolve. The second big point is that the role of energy pricing and also energy taxation is absolutely critical. As an economist, I do not think that energy efficient technologies will be adopted if energy is actually subsidized. You can dream of forcing people to do it, but that's really not going to work. You do need to make sure, you need a comprehensive review of the present system of energy pricing, and also to look at how we can get rid of these implicit subsidies. Now, part of the problem, I mean, one simple solution, of course, is that energy prices must cover costs in the sense that the energy producers aren't making losses because that has to be subsidized by the budget, which has many other demands upon it. But I think you need to go beyond that, and I think Nick will comment on this also, that, you know, the costs of pollution have to be factored into the cost of energy. He will give you some estimates of what these costs are. But recent studies done by the IMF and the World Bank and so on indicate that the costs of pollution could be as high as, you know, 5% of GDP. So the issue that we better impose a tax that will discourage polluting fuels, use the proceeds of the tax to subsidize energy-efficient alternatives, and the gain you get is not going to be seen in conventionally measured GDP, but in a reduction in pollution costs. And I think the transition, in our paper we bring out, the transition involves capital costs with fuel savings later on. And the average capital cost in the first 15 years is about 1.5% of GDP. So you need to work out, would that lower growth? Maybe it might lower GDP growth. 1.5% can easily be offset through greater productivity, other resource mobilization, certainly taxes on fuels. This is the most difficult part, by the way, of the whole thing. And it's very difficult for anyone in government or in political office to actually recommend imposing taxes. But, you know, I would say that at present, there's a general consensus that India is under tax. There's a general consensus that our tax revenue is not adequate. And in those environments, the obvious tax to put is on the things that are actually doing a lot of harm. And that brings in carbon taxation. So Nick will pick up on this after me. We need also to supplement this with the role of regulation. I mean, this is not, you can't rely just on prices. And certainly in energy, setting standards, some things the government has already done, for example, beyond a certain point, all the new thermal plants are going to have to be supercritical, that sort of thing, plus standards for cars, standards for fuel, the whole list of regulatory measures. And if these are taken with adequate advance warning to industry, there is no reason why industry cannot adjust. I should point out, by the way, that if the world brings its own energy down to the levels they're talking about, then there will be a great explosion of energy, energy-saving technology, and we need to be ready to be able to absorb this. So our own flexibility will look greater than it is today. Two other points before I ask Nick to step in. One is clarity of policy. You know, in the whole energy issue, it is very important for us to get out of this mood where we, every time there's a budget, we look for some new miracle which Arvind and his colleagues will produce and it'll show up there. I think we need a clear statement. What is our energy policy going to be of a kind that would encourage government not to depart from it? Because, you know, if people are going to make investments on the basis of something being more energy efficient, they need clarity over the next 20 years. And that's true as much for incentives. For example, what is the policy on solar, photovoltaic? I mean, is it just an incentive that can be removed tomorrow? Or is there some deeper, longer-term commitment? So you need a lot of clarity of policy. And last, and this is really, I just mentioned it, you know, a lot of this is linked to the urbanization, the strategy for sustainable urbanization. Isha mentioned that ICRIER is doing a lot of work in this jointly with the new climate economy. I mean, by 2050, 75% of GDP will be produced in urban areas. So if we want an energy efficiency strategy, that has to be a strategy that will have to be implemented in the cities. And the same thing is true of transport, where the cities are going to be absolutely crucial in finding new and less energy inefficient ways of moving people. So with those words, let me invite Nick to basically range over the same ground. Plus, you've got your slide.
Thank you very much to Isha and Rajat for inviting me today. And thank you to my old friend, Dr. Manmohan Singh, for coming. Dr. Manmohan Singh bears many responsibilities in the past. And one of those responsibilities is bringing me to India in 1974. He was the co-conspirator with T.N. Srinivasan. And I've been coming ever since. So thank you very much for bringing me and always talking to me when I come. Thank you, Manmohan. And thank you to my collaborators, Montek and Himanshu. Montek I've been arguing with and talking with for 45 years, I think. Himanshu more recently. Less arguments, but great pleasure in collaboration. So thank you very much. Now, I want to talk about costs and investments and then something on international comparisons and where the world might be going and whether India can be more creative and get ahead of the game to its own benefit. I think it can, and we're already trying to make that case. Now, let me start with the cost side. It's been clear that we've tried to be fairly ambitious on energy efficiency arguments and what we've built in to the models. You might think it's stretching beyond belief. I actually don't think it's stretching beyond belief. And in the changing world over the years between now, the three decades between now and 2047, we're going to learn tremendously along the way, and India can be a big part of that learning process. So why don't I think that this is what we can think of as stretch is actually stretching too far? I think we might be able to do better. And let me describe a little bit how. If you just think of efficiency, we are moving through an age where we have the fastest technical progress that the world has ever seen. We have revolutions in digital. Who knows how far we've gone in digital? Probably it's surprising if we've gone halfway. It's probably a lot less than that. We have a transformation in materials. Materials can do all sorts of things. Your buildings will have electricity generation built into them, and they will have much better insulation. That's largely a materials story. And we have the whole transformation of biotechnology. Those three things, I mean, there is more, but those three things are going on at the same time. And there is extraordinary potential in putting those three things together. Smart buildings, smart cities, we should think of as being efficient buildings, efficient cities, and cleaner buildings, cleaner cities. What we will be, and this is a big part of the story. So let me pursue that a little bit, and that's really my second point. City and city design will be absolutely critical here. We have the choice in the world over the next 20 or 30 years of building cities where you can move and breathe and be productive, or building cities much like the ones we have at the moment, where it's increasingly difficult to move and increasingly difficult to breathe. And of course, as a result of that, you're much less productive. So the design of cities will be absolutely fundamental. And India has an advantage in that it's a bit behind on urbanization relative to other countries. It has choices to avoid lock-in to bad ways of doing things, which are not necessarily so easily available elsewhere. So first, there are lots of margins on efficiency from the kind of new technologies I've described. And second, there's the whole question of city design. Most of this story, simply because where GDP is located, most of this story is about cities. Now, throughout the 40 years I've been coming to India, I've been working in one village in Moradabad district of UP. So I have absolutely no predilection to put to one side rural areas. I'm simply looking at the numbers and saying, if you're talking about productivity and efficiency, the bigger part of the story is in cities. And so India has a tremendous opportunity there. Thirdly, I've been talking mostly about what we know already, but so much more, and you can do a tremendous amount with what we know already, but so much more is coming. I was on a panel with Sam Pitroda in Goa on Friday. If you think we're being radical, you should listen to Sam about what's coming and what they see. Driverless cars are already on the roads in the United States. They're already on the roads, beginning in the UK. That is an example of the way you can rewrite public and private transport. It becomes a sort of hybrid of public and private transport, whilst at the same time investing in public transport. There are huge options developing there with a combination of the kinds of things I've described, in this case, digital and materials. So the investment in discovery is a real opportunity. And Prime Minister Modi launched on 30th November in Paris, I mean, some of us were there for that, he launched the International Solar Coalition of 120 countries. And at the press conference, he said, as fossil fuels put the planet in peril, hopes for future prosperity in the developing world, now depend on bold initiatives. And he went on to talk about a sunrise of a new hope. And he said, mornings and evenings filled with a clear view of the glory of the sun. Key points there. The first point was about climate change. But the second point was about pollution. And they're both very important. And these were packaged around innovation and solar innovation with India's leadership. And that's a tremendous opportunity. Finally, and very important, there's the cost of capital. This is a story where infrastructure investment in India, whichever way you look at it, not just from the point of view of the kinds of efficiencies and pollutions we're talking about, but also from the point of view of getting by in everyday productive life, infrastructure investment in India should arguably move from about 4% of GDP to about 8% of GDP. That's a big step up. And the composition of that infrastructure should be efficient and clean. But it's going to have to step up anyway if India is to avoid the great infrastructure bottlenecks that that it faces. Well, if you move from around 4% of GDP to about 8% of GDP, you're probably talking in terms of an increase of around, let's say, $80 billion a year to $150 billion a year, roughly something like that. The total lending of the MDBs, the regional development banks and the World Bank, the total lending is about $70 billion. And we're talking about more or less that much. So it's very clear that this has to be partnership with private sector. It's very clear that it has to be quite strongly levered. Otherwise, you couldn't get to that sort of scale. But what we do know is that you can get that leverage and you can bring down the cost of capital if the development banks are in the deal, if they're part of the story. I was chief economist of the EBRD in London for 6 years before I went to be chief economist of the World Bank. There were companies that could have bought the entire EBRD, but nevertheless wanted to lend with it because its presence in the deal brought down the cost of capital because it made people less nervous. And what Montek described is absolutely fundamental. Nervousness about future policy is a big disincentive to investment and exerts big upward pressure on the cost of capital. So we have to find ways, if we are to see that expansion in infrastructure investment of $70 billion a year or so in India, of development banks, and we, I hope, would be talking about Indian development banks as well as multilateral development banks, and the two development banks that India has played such a big part in creating, which is the Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank and the New Development Bank, the BRICS Bank. And we see that the Asia Development Bank has actually got this infrastructure message pretty strongly. So the potential is there. Forgetting about the World Bank, the potential is there for those three collaborator banks. But I think you have some start on that in India Infrastructure Finance Corporation in India. It's obviously very small at the moment, but there are possibilities in the Indian collaborative side as well. But unless we have that kind of collaboration, we'll not be able to bring down the cost of capital and we'll not be able to bring down, raise the overall flow. I mean, just think about how much this matters. If you can reduce the cost of capital from about 8% real down to 4% real, it should be possible to do that with the right kind of collaboration. If you've got a renewable, which is 70% capital cost, that one play reduces the cost by 35%. You divide 70% or 70 of the cost by a half. That's a very big deal. So all four of the elements I've described, the big possibilities in efficiency from these new technologies we already know about, city design, the discovery story with the major solar innovation initiatives of India, and Mission Innovation, which was also launched at Paris. Those are real possibilities. So I really don't think that when we've talked about stretch, that we've talked about implausibility. Actually, I think we could do rather better. But it involves a lot of investment and making that investment efficient and clean. But those are investments with very high returns. We should distinguish between cost and investment. If you make a very profitable investment, you shouldn't put that to one side as a cost. It's what it says it is. It's a very profitable investment if you talk about its efficiency returns and its pollution returns. So that's the bigger part of what I wanted to say. Let me just mention the cost of coal. Coal is not cheap. Coal is very expensive if you look at the human consequences of the pollution. Let me just give you a feel of how big these numbers are. Suppose the pollution, I'm giving you a way of doing it rather than putting my head on the block for the numbers. But suppose you kill 1/10 of 1% of the population, 1 in 1,000 each year. Now, it's not quite that, but it's not so far away. Suppose you kill 1 in 1,000, and suppose the cost of a life, which is the way, I mean, it's rather vulgar, but normally in these calculations, when you're talking about road accidents, hospitals, and so on, you take about 100 times GDP per capita. It's actually fairly common across countries. The precise numbers don't matter here, but the order of magnitude does matter. So you kill 1 in 1,000 a year, A life is 100 times GDP. So you can immediately say that's 10% of GDP. Doesn't matter which country you're talking about. Yeah? That's 10% of GDP. Well, if you say, actually, we kill a bit less than that, or the value of life is a bit less than that, then you come down from 10%. If you kill half that number, it would be 5% of GDP. If you say the cost of a life in India is, notwithstanding most people do 100, it's 50, then you bring it down to 2.5%. But what's clear is it's big. This is not some minor thing you brush into the corner. This is big. If you had $100 a tax per ton of coal, yeah, I know that sounds large, but it's small, actually, relative to the numbers I've just given you, that would raise about 3% of GDP. 100 times 600 million tons is 60 billion, which is roughly 3% of GDP. Now, I know it would take a brave finance minister, and I'm looking at my friend Arvind here, to put $100 a ton on coal, which costs $50 a ton, but it is less than justified by the kind of pollution. Forget about climate change. It's less than justified in terms of, it's less. Can you hear me all right in the back? I should have asked before. Yes? Very good, very good. So when we talk about revenue raising, Montek said, tax the bad. Here is a huge opportunity. And of course, there's diesel and petrol and so on as well. There's a huge opportunity. I spent quite a bit of time in a finance ministry, and I'm hardwired to look for revenue, not just talk about what to spend, but looking for revenue. You don't have to look very far. Tax the bad things, and there's a tremendous potential there. Let me finally say a few words internationally. We've just come from Paris and COP21, the International Agreement on Climate Change, in which India played a very positive role. Very early collaboration on the first day on the innovation initiatives, which created not only important initiatives, but also a good mood for what followed. It was a very collaborative atmosphere, actually. The people argue about lots of things and lots of details, but the atmospherics were good, and that early announcement on innovation made a big difference. India was not defensive this time round. India has been defensive in the past. You know, who are you to tell us what to do? We don't emit very much. You guys filled up the atmosphere with all this lot of greenhouse gases, and now you're asking us to do things differently. All of that is true. Every bit of what I just said is true. But it's a question of what you deduce from that. And what we're talking about is a way of growing. Way of growing in a much better way. This is about better growth and a better climate. So that was very strong. Now, so the world said we should be aiming not just for 2 degrees, but less than, well below, was the language, and we should try to see how close we can get to 1.5. So this was not an international agreement which says, well, 2 degrees, well, actually we mean a number beginning with 2. Maybe 2.5 or 6 or 7. No, it was below 2. This is a number beginning with 1. And that was a major change in the emphasis of the scale of what we do. That was the first thing. The second thing was the honesty in where we were going. We are going way above that if you look at people's intentions. So the third thing, as you say in India, is what to do. The third thing was to say, we have to meet in 5 years' time, having assessed in 3 years' time, to discuss how we're going to ramp up ambitions. So this paper is in that spirit. How could it be done? And that's what we tried to work on. So that's the Paris story. It was remarkable. The 195 countries came together to sign up. Getting 195 countries to sign anything is extraordinary. Getting them to sign something ambitious is almost beyond belief. But they did. Why? Because this is an issue that's understood much better now, not only in the dangers of climate change, but also in all the gains and attractions of doing things differently. And Rajat Katuria led a study around the Better Growth, Better Climate work of India, which set out that in some detail. So that's the story of Paris. Now, if India embarked on the kind of story that we've described, or if it didn't, if it went to BAU, how would it compare with other countries? And I think I've got China, should be here. Am I going the right way or the wrong way here? Yeah, so this is India and China. Red, quite appropriately, is China. And this is the past. So looking backwards, China's emissions are way, way above India. Yeah? I mean, as a rule of thumb, China's GDP per capita is four times India. And you know, it's, that's not far away from being true of emissions as well. And if you look forward, oh, I've done that again. If you look forward, then this is very rough extrapolation for China, thinking about what it promised in Paris. It promised to be peaking around 2030. My own work with one or two others suggests that actually China would peak about 2025. But this this story, as you can see, would keep India well below China, maybe a factor more like three than four, but well below China in 2030. And India would do its peaking at a much earlier stage of development than China. And if you ask the Chinese now, would you have wished you had been peaking earlier? They'll say absolutely. They will say very clearly, if we knew 25 years ago what we now know about pollution and the ability to move in cities, we would have done things differently. India has that chance. And that way you can see that India on this blue line could actually meet what Dr. Mohan Singh indicated several years ago now, that it would always stay below the emissions per capita of the rich countries. Under business as usual, the other graphs that we were talking about, that would not be true. But under this one, it would be true. And that is not just altruistic. It is altruistic in the narrow sense of a very good outcome, but it is actually enormously to the benefit of India, in particularly through cities where you can move and breathe and bring up your children and be productive. So I think we're talking about a great opportunity. We've been stretching the margin a bit, but actually I think it's possible to do even better, to the great gain of growth and welfare and poverty reduction. Thank you.
Thank you, Nick. With this now, we have presentation of the study over, and we have Dr. Arvind Subramanian, the Chief Economic Advisor to the Government of India, as our first discussant. Arvind, please. Abhine.
Good morning, everyone. It's a real honor to be here in the presence of, you know, Dr. Manmohan Singh, Isher, Montek, Nick, Raju, and everyone else here. I'm a bit of an interloper on climate change. I'm not an expert, and Ajay will, you know, probably give much more substantive comments. I just want to begin by saying, just to get a lesson in algebra from my role model, Montek, at this stage in life, is itself worth the morning, I think. You know, E upon G is equal to E upon M into M upon E. So I'll always remember that Montek as a good algebra lesson. And also, it's always wonderful to see Nick's kind of optimism and earnestness about this, and the amount he's contributed to just shaping, you know, the debate internationally and just moving us in the right direction is just simply extraordinary. So it's a real honor to have Nick here. Let me begin by saying that, as Nick said, Paris was a very good outcome. And I think the government, the prime minister, and also people like Ajay, I'm told, played a, an amazing role in this, and it was quite an achievement. And I've always felt that climate change is something that India should take very seriously because it's in our interest. I mean, if you know, go back a few years, you remember the Kosi flood, and of course we've had four successive seasons of droughts. We've had the Chennai flood, and God knows what looms ahead. For example, in planning next year, doing these growth projections and so on that we do, we sort of take comfort in the fact that, you know, you can't have three successive seasons of bad agriculture because it's never happened in the past. But in the new world, that's no longer something you can take for granted, and therefore, you know, it's kind of climate change is really very, very important for India, for agriculture, for farmers and everything. So I think Paris was wonderful in that respect. But I think we have to make clear that Paris is just the starting point. I mean, there's a long, long, long slog ahead. And I want to spend the rest of my time, my comments into three parts. I want to talk about the scenario and the international dimension, the national dimension, and I kind of want to end on a kind of a policy note or a slightly hopeful note about what may or may not happen. On the scenarios, I think they're very sensible. I think it makes a lot of sense. I haven't been through all the gory detail, but I'm sure it's true. But one thing, you know, there's a kind of technical point I want to make and a kind of policy point I want to make, a little bit of finger pointing at some people as well. I think on the technical point, whenever scenarios like this are presented, we know it's full of so many assumptions and things that go into it. I like scenarios at least to say, you know, these are one or two key assumptions, and if those change, how do these scenarios change? I think that's kind of, and for me, I think there are three things which I really, in some revision, I would like to see, is that what does this assume about carbon pricing by the West? Let me say, Nick, I am completely unimpressed with the contributions of advanced countries. We've seen the biggest setback, I would say, one of the biggest setbacks to climate change efforts in the form of this big reduction in the price of energy, and very few advanced countries have in fact responded in any way by imposing any energy tax of any consequence. I think we should claim credit where credit is due. I think at considerable political cost, this government has done exactly the opposite. It's not been very popular, but I think that in petroleum, at least, we have implicit carbon taxes, Nick, at current levels, which are probably close to $100 a ton. You know, we did the calculation for the economic survey, but since then we've had more. And so I think that I'm very, very skeptical and anxious going forward, but that's a policy point. But as a technical point, I'd like to see these scenarios kind of do some sensitivity to what are the implicit assumptions about it. The second, I think, assumption I want to see always is, you know, what are the assumptions about the prices of renewables going forward? And here I agree with something that Nick said. I think that the point with, you know, all of us are guilty of this. We all do smooth scenarios. And I'd love to see a kind of disruptive scenario where actually renewables become, you know, really de facto, not in this funny math way of saying, oh, it's almost competitive with coal. The real, everything built in, the intermittency built in, the storage built in, the capital cost built in. You know, if that really would happen, how does this change these scenarios? Is something that I would love to see. The other thing I would love to see, and this is something that, I mean, there are two points I'm going to disagree with Nick on. Is something about, you know, what are we assuming about, you know, the technology of clean coal. I mean, I think underlying this assumption is that, you know, coal is as dirty, even in the low carbon scenario as today, and I'd like to see some sensitivity to that. So I think the on a technical and policy sense, I would love to see how that happens. My next point relates to, you know, the national agenda or the national dimension. I look at table 9 in the box 9, and I say hallelujah, you know, all power to this, because in a sense, if you look at box 9, it's first best development policy, you know, power perfectly reformed, agriculture, all the subsidies gone, urbanization is as we should want, transport policy is as we should ideally have it, and therefore, you know, if we did all that, I don't think we'd need climate change policy because, you know, everything would solve itself. So in that sense, I think that, you know, I think it's a useful listing, but I would like to see a little bit more, you know, not this everything in the kitchen sink, but, you know, something a little bit more concrete, prioritized, and so on. And I'll come to that in a second in my concluding remarks. I have a slight, you know, it may be a taste difference, but it's certainly a substantive difference between, you know, the approach here and some of the things that also Nick said. I think that my own view is that you need a combination of policy, which I think is actually first order and something that Montek referred to, and you need financing. But to me, financing cannot be the horse that that leads the cart. I think financing, to stick my neck out, is second order compared to the policy change. And you know, and if you can bring the cost of capital down, that's wonderful. If you can get the MDBs to spend more on this, that's wonderful. I think that, but I think that in the larger scheme of things, I do think that, you know, the policy change, the public investment agenda, something that governments control, I think is terribly important, and I would kind of put priority on that. Just as an aside, you know, when you look at that box 9, on the one hand, it's first bed development policy, but then you say, if this is what it takes to get it down, then you might as well not start because it's so daunting, the task. But it reminds me a little bit about, you know, the alarmism is a two-edged sword. You need to raise alarm to galvanize action, but if there's too much alarm and people say, oh my God, it's, you know, you can't deal with this in any case, so let's not start at all in the first place. So that list is very, very daunting, and I think that some kind of prioritization would be good. My last point, I think, is where I want to end, is that I don't want to sound at all in any by any means, you know, either you know, cynical or defeatist, but I do think there is a kind of hopeful agenda going forward that I think, you know, a kind of slightly more focused agenda that I think we could pursue going forward. I think first, you know, I'm a firm believer in you know, trying to see how can policy change not from top down, but also when there are pressures from below to change. And in this sense, I'm very, very encouraged by what's happening in India. You know, the kind of numbers that Nick was talking about, the costs of coal and so on. I do think the political economy of carbon taxation is changing, can change in India because of all, not just the pollution, but the health costs, the congestion costs. You know, whatever one might think of Audi, even, I, you know, I don't want to get into that. But I think there is an underlying, I think, imperative that I think is being captured there, which I think is really, really very useful and can be harnessed for very positive change going forward. I think, for example, even the fact that the Prime Minister started, you know, the daily monitoring of 27 cities, I think these are all things, you know, transparency and things from below, I think can really play a very positive role in terms of creating the pressures for policy change. That's I think my hopeful point number one. Point number two, I would say is that, you know, amongst the priorities, I mean, you know, this is by no means am I saying that my prioritization is superior to anything else that anyone is going to say. But I think that, you know, the public investment agenda, especially, you know, for example, in railways, and the Honorable Minister is going to come now. I think if you look at what has happened in India, the kind of the distortions that have been created by underinvestment in railways and the fact that roads have played such a big role, if we can reverse that, and I'm hopeful that, you know, the minister will actually has a very ambitious agenda for doing it, and the government is committed to supporting public investment railways, I think that could have a really a first order effect in this. Third, I mean, of course, Montek is absolutely right in terms of energy pricing. It's, you know, I once wrote an article saying that probably the single biggest, worst policy distortion in India might be what the pricing of power in India, but, you know, that's just a comment. But I think that the whole technology and what we would call the jam revolution, I think creates the opening finally for, I think, you know, getting working on these subsidies. I think whether it's power, whether it's cooking gas, you know, cooking gas has been so successful, the whole DBT experiment. And I think if we can extend that to, you know, fertilizer, power, I think that creates the basis for actually, because otherwise, you know, reforming energy prices, as many here know much better than I do, is really such a politically difficult thing. But now we're getting the, you know, the technology piece, you know, the jam, the DBT piece for that. And I think some people have even started working on, you know, how we should think about doing a direct benefit transfer for power, for example, and that would be a game changer. And I think that, you know, the efforts that are being made to start metering and so on, I think it's probably a medium-term program, but I think that's going to be, that also for me is a very hopeful sign going forward. On, you know, urbanization, again, I couldn't agree with you more, Nick and others and Montek who've said that, but I do think that that is a message that has to be taken, you know, to governments, and I do think that it's so much tied up with reform of urban governance. I don't think we get, you know, clean cities unless we get, you know, smart cities. We don't get smart cities unless we get well-governed cities with all the fiscal and the accountability mechanisms that have to go with it. So, you know, so that too is for me a pretty very important but a very daunting agenda because, I mean, frankly, I don't think, you know, I forget whether it's 73 or 74, but I think in some sense, you know, giving teeth to that at a fundamental governance thing is probably going to be the key to addressing, you know, the green city part of urbanization, which I think is very, very important. My last point is a little bit of a disagreement with Nick. I think that, you know, while I completely agree with the numbers that we've heard on the costs of the marginal social costs of coal, I think, as I said, you know, the political economy is changing where we can begin to think of internalizing some of these domestic marginal costs. We're not there to internalize, you know, all this domestic marginal cost, social costs. We're certainly not ready to internalize some of the international social costs of coal. But I do think that, you know, this has to become, I mean, we cannot have an agenda, I feel, which says we have to, you know, get rid of coal by taxing it very high. I think we are at a stage in development where coal is going to be used. It's going to be, quote, at least in some quasi-private social sense, is going to be the cheapest form of energy. And I think that it's wishful thinking, and I think it's a little bit unfair as well to kind of wish away coal in India. Just as an aside, I might say that, you know, One of India's biggest contributions to climate change over the last 10 years has been the inefficiency of the coal sector. Had we been more efficient on coal, I think our emissions would have looked very, very different. But that's an aside on this. So I think that we have to have on the international agenda, both for me, fundamental, the West pricing carbon, putting its money where its mouth is, and an international effort, like a war effort to try and clean coal, because I think it has to be two-way on coal. You know, we do the technology, because I think, investing in cleaning coal has become a complete casualty of the whole world becoming enamored with renewables. I think renewables are good, but as Montek said, you know, it's going to have some limits in India because of its situation vis-a-vis electricity. But I think we need to have, you know, we price tax carbon to some extent, but it has to be combined with an international effort to clean coal, because coal is going to be and should be very important for our energy going forward. So just to conclude, climate change is, I mean, absolutely terribly, terribly important for India. You know, we are going to be affected, as all of you know. All these numbers show that we are going to be affected probably along with sub-Saharan Africa the most compared to any other thing. So it's in our vital interest, and that's why Paris is a very good first step. I think the domestic agenda is very daunting, but I think I see hopeful signs of us, you know, moving forward. But I do think that the international community has to, you know, kind of cooperate in some important ways to help us, you know, as Nick concluded by saying, to get both energy access, growth, but also saving the planet. Thank you very much.